All right. In this lecture, we want to quickly introduce exponential and logarithmic numbers and see how we can preserve our significant figures when using these types of values in our scientific computations.
First, let's review what an exponential number looks like. Simple positive exponents, such as a superscript n, reads as either a to the nth power or the nth power of a. This mathematical symbolism is equivalent to the math where a is multiplied by itself n times. The a is called the base and n is called the exponent. So 2 to the 4th would be the same as 2 times 2 times 2 times 2, where 2 is the base and 4 is the exponent. The more common exponents are a squared, or a to the power of 2, and a cubed, which is a to the power of 3. When a number has a negative exponent written as a to the power of minus n, the number can be rewritten in its inverse form as shown, and now the sign of the exponent on the a variable in the denominator is positive. As we've seen before, if the exponent of a number is ever zero, such as a to the zeroth power, then the resultant value, no matter the quantity that a represents, will be unity, or 1. Fractions with positive and negative exponents also can occur. Some examples of these fractional values with exponents are shown along with some of the more useful manipulations. Now, it is prudent for us to look at example exponential numbers where the common base is the value 10. For powers of 10 where the exponent is a positive integer n, the product can be written as a 1 with n zeros. For powers of 10 with a negative integer exponent, such as 10 to the power of minus n, the product can be written as a decimal fraction with n minus 1 zeros between the decimal point and the 1. We can also have fractional exponents of the form n divided by m. For such a number, such as a to the power of n divided by m, we are actually taking the nth root of a to the nth power. Look carefully at the examples that are shown in all of the equivalent ways that these numbers can be written. When multiplying two exponential numbers of the same base, you add the exponents. An example would be 10 to the power of 2 times 10 to the power of minus 6, which gives us 10 to the power of minus 4, where the exponent 2 and minus 6 were added to get the exponent minus 4. When dividing two exponential numbers of the same base, you subtract the exponent of the numerator top by the exponent of the denominator bottom. So if we have 10 to the power of 12 divided by 10 to the power of 7, we can rewrite it as 10 to the power 5, where we subtract 7 from 12 to get the 5 exponent. Now, raising an exponential number to a power, you would multiply the exponents. For example, 10 to the power of 2nd to the power of minus 1 is just a fancy way of saying 10 to the power of minus 2. Now, how do we incorporate sigfigs into our exponential math? For simplicity, we can treat simple problems utilizing our rules for multiplication and division. For 4.2 to the power of 3, where 4.2 has two sigfigs, if we rewrite the problem as three multiplications and obey our regular rules, we can assume the answer will have to be two sigfigs as well. Now, for multiplication, division, and addition, subtraction of numbers that have been written in scientific notation, which we already know will be a common way for us to write down many of our scientific values, it's important. So we need to master the following examples. First, let's do the easier multiplication and division example. When we compute 4.24 times 10 to the power of minus 3 times 7.592 times 10 to the power 10, we first gather the numbers in front of each scientific notation value together, the 4.24 and 7.592 values, and multiply them together. We then gather the base 10 exponentials together, 10 to the power of minus 3 and 10 to the power of 10, and then compute by adding the exponents, 10 to the power of minus 3 plus 10. Now all we have to do is put everything back together, obtaining the value 32.19008 times 10 to the power of 7. To determine the correct sigfigs, we only look at the first part of the computation, the 4.24 times 7.592 part. We see that the value 4.24 has the smallest number of sigfigs, 3 in this case, so that is why we underline the 1 in the result, and we finish by rounding off the value, giving us 32.2 times 10 to the power of 7. To get an answer in the proper normalized scientific notation form, the last step involves moving the decimal to the left, which means we must add 1 to the exponent, giving us the value 3.22 times 10 to the power of 8. The final result now clearly has 3 sigfigs. When doing an addition subtraction problem, we have to add a few steps. Let's do the subtraction of 4.24 times 10 to the power of minus 3 minus 7.592 times 10 to the power of minus 5. In this problem, we first want to rewrite the quantity so that both numbers have the same base 10 exponents. I find it easier to calculate the sigfigs if I make sure that both numbers have an exponential value equal to that of the largest number, in this case, 4.24 times 10 to the power of minus 3. To get a minus 3 exponent on the second number, we would need to add 2 to the exponent, which means from Lars, we have to move the decimal place left 2 spots, resulting in the value 0.07592 times 10 to the power of minus 3. Now, since both numbers are of the same power of minus 3, we can factor out the 10 to the power of minus 3 and work on the subtraction. 4.24 minus 0.07592 directly. Now we've obtained from that subtraction the value 4.16408. We underline the 6 because we know that the 4.2 value is the least precise value in the parentheses. Finally, we round off and make sure our result is in the proper scientific notation form, obtaining a value 4.16 times 10 to the minus 3, having 3 sigfigs. We come to a specialty case of exponentials that is commonly used for calculating acid-base pH and used in chemical equilibrium computations, logarithmic and anti-logarithmic math. For numbers of the form a to the power b equals c, we can rewrite the exponential form into a logarithmic form shown, where a is now called the base. In chemistry, the typical bases would be either the exponential e, called the natural logarithm, or the base 10, which is known simply as log. Logarithmic math is pretty straightforward and is governed by the 3 laws written here. When calculating a logarithm using our calculators, the resulting number, such as the base 10 log of 5.5 times 10 to the power of minus 4, would give us minus 3.2596 and so forth. On my calculator, the decimal values just keep going. Try it. The result can be broken down into what we call the characteristic, which is the integer part of a log, the minus 3 in this example, and the mantissa, which is the fractional or decimal part of the log, the 0.2596 part of our example. Now the question is, how do we incorporate sigfigs so we know where to round off the mantissa in a logarithmic calculation? The sigfig math rules for logs or anti-logs are as follows. The sigfig rule for a log calculation is that the number of sigfigs of the original number will determine the number of digits of the mantissa of the computed value. So most of the time, you end up with a value that looks like it has one more sigfig than the value you started with. The reason for this is that the characteristic is assumed to be an exact value. So for our example, our final answer is minus 3.26, rounding off at the hundredths position. The original number, 5.5 times 10 to the power of minus 4, has 2 sigfigs, so we must have 2 numbers in the mantissa, 0.26. when we take the antilog of a value, such as the antilog of 4.267, we recognize this is the same as taking the base to the exponent of the number, 10 to the power of 4.267. Now let's write down the Sigfig rule governing this antilog computation. For an antilog of a number, the number of a sigfigs in the mantissa of the exponent will determine the total number of the sigfigs in the final value. In the example shown, we observe that there are only three decimal numbers in the mantissa of the exponent, the 0.267 part. The rule tells us that we must only have three total sigfigs in our final numerical result. When we plug 10 to the power of 4.267 into a calculator, we get a large number, 18,492.686 in sum. We know the final value must only have three sigfigs. It is best to rewrite the value in scientific notation to avoid ambiguity, and then we can easily round off to the required three sigfigs, obtaining a final value of 1.85 times 10 to the power of 4. In the case where we do math with powers containing fractional exponents, we can apply the same rule. For the example shown, we have used addition, subtraction, and log rules to obtain the correct sigfigs on the final answer. Look carefully at each step to make sure you understand the result. Remember, we don't round off until the very end. Okay, so let's have some fun. Armed with all these rules for sigfigs in math, we can cover even the most complex of computations. As long as we keep track of the sigfigs at each computational step, carry only enough digits to make sense, and rounding off when we finally get to the very end. So let's do the following calculation. We first work within the parentheses and do the exponential computation. Now we will do the multiplication. Next comes the addition, followed by the log. Now it's time to divide. We rewrite the scientific notation to make the next calculation easier. We're close to being done, okay? We can now do the addition. And finally, we round off to the appropriate sigfigs, giving us 18.8 as the final answer.
Now that was one mean computation. Don't panic. Fortunately, those kinds of problems are rare in beginning chemistry, but it's just cool to see how all the sigfig math rules work together. And don't feel frustrated about having to refer back to these last sigfig math videos very often. I know that I have to remind myself all the time about all the various math and sigfig rules. That's okay. Just stay with it, and you'll lock it all down. See you soon.